Hello and welcome to Hidden Archives. In this episode, I will be talking about Francis Walsingham, the Elizabethan master of espionage. In 1588, England almost lost its independence. An invasion by the Spanish Armada was narrowly avoided. Now, many credit the defeat of the Spanish Armada to the superior tactics and seamanship of the English Navy, and of course they deserve credit for this, but what's often overlooked is the role played by Elizabethan masters of espionage, not only in thwarting the invasion, but in thwarting numerous plots to overthrow Queen Elizabeth and replace her with a Catholic monarch. In the end, it was a combination of good seamanship and espionage that saved England. Now, to understand what led to the Spanish Armada, we're going to have to dive into the political and economic situation in Europe at the time. England and Wales were united, but most of Ireland and Scotland were outside of England's control. In Ireland, the English did control a small area around Dublin known as the Pale. Anything outside that area was considered to be a land of barbarians by the English. In fact, they refer to that as beyond the pale, a phrase that remains in the language to this day. Scotland was an ever-present thorn in the side of the English monarchs during this time, and there was a fear it could become a base for invading England if it became aligned with a continental power like France. And Mary, the Queen of Scots, being Catholic, that was definitely a concern. Most English military power during this time consisted of local untrained militias that the Queen could summon, which would have been very little use against professional soldiers of Spain or France. To summon the militia, the Queen needed both money to pay them and the approval of Parliament, which wasn't always a given, since the English had an aversion to a large standing army, which was an attitude that carried over to the American colonies later on. England's standing army at this time consisted of only 200 Royal Guards and a few hundred extra men manning coastal forts along the English Channel. Compared to this, the French could field 10,000 highly trained professional soldiers, and the Spanish could easily field twice as many. Both countries also had navies dwarfing that of England, so we can see England was not a military power by any stretch of the imagination. Now, Spain was at the height of its power with a vast overseas empire in the New World. It had swallowed up the Portuguese, it controlled much of Germany and the Netherlands, and it also controlled part of the Italian peninsula where they fought the enemies of the Pope. France wasn't as strong as Spain yet, but it was a rising power and would eventually eclipse Spain in the next century. There were some divisions in France, though. There was a large Protestant minority there called the Huguenots, a minority that the Catholic kings wanted to rid themselves of, and this led to a series of civil wars in France during this period. The central character in thwarting Catholic designs on England was Francis Walsingham. Now, Admiral Sir John Hawkins and Sir Francis Drake were instrumental in the actual battle against the Armada, but they relied on Walsingham and others for intelligence on the movement of the French and Spanish fleets. Now, England's tense relationship with Spain goes back to before Elizabeth's reign. The Spanish King Philip II had married Elizabeth's half-sister Mary when Mary was queen, and Mary and Philip had executed over 300 Protestants, burning them at the stake in Smithfield. This was in an effort to stamp out Protestantism in England and restore Catholicism, but many English began to see Catholicism as a foreign faith, particularly due to their queen's marriage to a foreign Catholic king. Now, when Mary died in 1558, Elizabeth became queen and the Protestant faith was restored, but Philip hadn't given up on restoring Catholicism in England, and he seems to have seen it as his mission in life to bring all of Christendom back under the rule of Rome. As Elizabeth came to the throne, Walsingham returned from overseas, where he'd gone to escape Mary's persecution of the Protestants. Now, though Francis Walsingham was nominally an English Puritan, he was more reserved in how he expressed his views to the Queen. It's also possible he may have been involved with some of the secret hermetic societies, although there's no direct evidence of this. He was associated with various members of those societies, like Francis Bacon, John Dee, Christopher Marlowe, and his own son-in-law, Philip Sidney. Dee is known to have conducted intelligence operations for the Queen herself, and to have used the code 007 in his secret correspondence with her. That's right, he was the original 007. And in fact, this is where Ian Fleming got the inspiration for using that code name for his James Bond character, whom he originally meant to develop into a sort of modern-day Dr. John Dee. Walsingham became Elizabeth's spymaster just after his return from France, where he'd served as Elizabeth's ambassador, and had witnessed the St. Bartholomew's Day Massacre in August of 1572, when the Catholics turned on and murdered many of the Protestants living in and around Paris. Now, after returning to England, he quickly set about building the English spy network into a force to be reckoned with, eventually numbering somewhere in the vicinity of 500 agents who operated even as far away as Constantinople. Now, before Walsingham's time, most intelligence was gained by listening to merchants who traveled in the region of interest or by bribing a courtier of a rival king. But there was no organization approaching the scale of modern agencies. Walsingham, he pioneered many of the various modern practices in his network, such as interception of communications, developing long-term sleeper agents, and using known double agents to feed disinformation to the other side. Another tactic he used was planting agents in prison to establish a cover, making it easier for them to infiltrate the ranks of various Catholic conspiracies against Elizabeth. As he developed a strong intelligence and counterintelligence apparatus, he thwarted numerous plots against Elizabeth. Most of these were connected to Mary Stuart, the Queen of Scotland. Now, Elizabeth's hold on power in England depended largely on playing France and Spain off against one another. She couldn't afford to allow either to gain the upper hand. If France became too powerful, they needed to be afraid of Spanish intervention so they wouldn't move against England. But at the same time, the Spanish needed to be afraid of the French before they tried an invasion of their own. In 1570, Pope Pius V issued papal bull Regnans in Excelsis, which excommunicated Elizabeth and called on Catholics everywhere to overthrow her and replace her with a Catholic monarch, all with the blessings of Rome. His proclamation also stated that anyone who followed her orders or disobeyed his order to depose her would fall under the same sentence. This turned the politics of England into a religious issue. For English Catholics, loyalty to Elizabeth was now disloyalty to Rome, and plots against her increased. One of these, the Ridolfi plot, was foiled by the English privateer John Hawkins, who pretended to join the plot while passing on all the information he received to Francis Walsingham. Mary, who was now a prisoner in England, was implicated in this, but Elizabeth refused to have her executed with the rest of the conspirators. Walsingham's old mentor, William Cecil, who was now Lord Burleigh, wanted peace with Spain and to use the Spanish to fend off the French. But Walsingham disagreed. He believed that Catholic Spain would never honor any peace agreement while Elizabeth was on the throne. He argued instead for supporting the Protestant opponents of France and Spain, including the Dutch, who were fighting for independence from Spain, and the Huguenots, who were being persecuted by the French king. In essence, he saw the struggle to be at its root religious in nature. Therefore, it made no sense to try to tame the opponents of England. Walsingham finally prevailed over Burleigh in his arguments, and war was declared on Spain in 1585. Troops were sent to the Netherlands. Walsingham, meanwhile, kept busy with the secret war at home. Catholic plots had intensified, and Walsingham foiled them one at a time, using informants among not only the conspirators, but among foreign diplomats who met with the conspirators. It's believed Christopher Marlowe was involved with Walsingham's organization at this time. Mary Stuart was finally implicated in the Babington plot in such a way that there was written proof of her involvement. As a result, Elizabeth was finally persuaded to sign the warrant for Mary's execution. She changed her mind at the last minute and tried to countermand the warrant, but her rescinded order came too late and Mary was executed on February 8, 1587. Meanwhile, Walsingham and Burleigh had been using their spies to keep track of the movements of the Spanish fleet. Francis Drake received orders to attack the Spanish Armada at its anchorage in Cadiz Harbor. The Queen changed her mind and issued a new set of orders forbidding Drake from attacking Spain, but the second set of orders was deliberately withheld by the Privy Council until after Drake had departed. His attack on Cadiz caused a great deal of damage and assured the Spanish would not be able to attack that year. But by May of 1588, they were ready again. The English had bought precious time, but they were still heavily outmatched. Elizabeth had only 34 galleons plus some other ships that could be temporarily added from the merchant marine. One advantage was that the small size of the English ships meant they were more maneuverable, but it remained to be seen if this would save them from the massive armada. Another thing the English had going for them was intelligence that the Spanish were coming due to Walsingham's spy network. Despite this, the English fleet came close to being trapped in the harbor, as the wind was against them, but at the last minute the wind shifted and they were able to sail out to challenge the Spanish galleons. By the 21st of May, the English had the weather on their side. While they fought the forces of the Spanish admiral, Medina Sidonia, their Dutch allies kept the Duke of Parma's forces bottled up in the harbor of Dunkirk with the help of a small English task force. Despite a galleon effort, sending fireships through the Spanish fleet, the English navy was doing little physical damage, but their attacks led many of the Spanish vessels to cut their anchor cables, resulting in the Spanish formation becoming very disorganized. At this point, a storm struck the English Channel, and many of the Spanish captains decided to flee. Since the English blocked the channel, they went north around Scotland and Ireland, but many of them were shipwrecked on the coast of Ireland, and then killed by the Irish. The defeat of the Spanish Armada was the beginning of the end for the Spanish Empire. Its defeat was not final, but it entered into a state of decline that would end with the loss of most of its overseas possessions, the last of which they would lose in 1898 when the United States Navy sailed into Manila Bay under Admiral Dewey. England entered an age of growing power which would culminate in the Victorian Age of the late 19th century. All of this would not have occurred, however, without the superior intelligence networks of the Elizabethan spy masters. Now, if you like this video, please like and subscribe. Thank you very much. Have a nice day.